On hot copy this morning, the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee eyeing to wrap its probe on the sugar importation mess soon. And joining us this morning for more on this and other probes being conducted by the committee, we have the committee's chairman, Senator Francis Tolentino. Senator Tolentino, good morning to you.
Good morning, ma'am. Good morning to your viewers as well.
All right. The executive secretary, Vic Rodriguez, has apparently sent you a letter that he will not be attending the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee hearings. This is correct?
Indeed, there was a letter sent to the committee, not just to me personally. And the contents would explain why his attendance would not be possible because of, quote-unquote, trying to get the gist that is preparing for the state visits, Indonesia, Singapore, and the next one would be the visit to the United Nations General Assembly of the President himself.
And you accept his excuse?
The acceptance or non-acceptance would not be mine alone, but would be a decision of a collegial body, the committee itself.
All right. What happens if the committee does not accept the executive secretary's reason?
Well, there will be repercussions coming from the committee. I cannot divulge this right now. So it will depend on the committee's decision on whether to do away with his attendance or really require him, because he's still expected to attend several meetings requiring his presence. You have the budget hearing, you have the commission on appointments, and all of the things that were not raised can be raised in those fora. So I will leave that to the committee members themselves.
All right. Is the executive secretary's presence important or vital when it comes to the sugar hearings? Because he did say that, I believe in the letter that he had sent, that he is one with the Senate in addressing corruption.
I think there are just two points that need clarification. If you look at the transcript of the stenographic notes during the last hearing, one, the perception of the SRA members that they were given the go signal to proceed with the SO number 4. But SO number 4 was aborted by the executive department itself. So with the claim of the good executive secretary, and here the presumption is good faith, is that it was a mere draft. It was never implemented. It was aborted. It was later on declared illegal.
Okay, that's one point. And then what's another clarification you would want?
The meeting that took place between the SRA members and the executive secretary. Yeah. And the other one was the non-answering of the text messages. Mm. So these are the three or two watershed moments, so to speak, that would need clarification. It can be clarified via Zoom, physical presence, or even through letters, through inquiries. He can make a deposition relative to this.
All right. Now, the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee is known, historically speaking, to either subpoena, in a way, invite is the more polite term, a source. But after repeated invitations and a source declines, the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee has in the past issued contempt or filed contempt charges against these sources. Now, given the fact that a majority of the Senate now supports this administration, are you seeing that as forthcoming if the executive secretary continues to decline the Senate's invitation?
Again, I cannot prejudge what the other members would do or decide, so I cannot speak for themselves. We will decide this collegially. So at the moment, in my view, we will still have to gather the consensus of the other members of the committee.
Yeah, because Senator Tolentino, just recently in the 18th Congress, we've seen the formally hearings, and the Senate was, I wouldn't say the word heavy-handed, but it exercised its right under the rules to actually issue contempt charges against sources who refused to attend. And frankly speaking, non-cooperative sources were even detained, if you remember that. So there might be a perception of bias, so to speak, if the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee acts differently when it comes to cabinet officials and sources that the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee needs.
I think perhaps that's your perception, but as I have stated during the start of my term, we have to do this on the basis of evidence, on the basis of facts, and on the basis of law.
Mm-mm.
So I wouldn't be too subjective.
And rules?
On this.
And what about the Senate rules?
Yes. Yeah. We do that. We follow the rules. And as your headline mentioned a while ago, well, there is going to be a conclusion to this. Mm. Unlike no offense meant, unlike previous hearings that led to a cliffhanger, never-ending investigation. So we will have an end to this.
Okay. All right. So two former executives, the former DA Undersecretary Sebastian.
So you're referring now. Yes. Go ahead.
Yeah. And a former SRA Administrator Serafica, in the hearing had stated that no less than the president supported the importation, asked them to craft an importation plan of some kind, and that there were no objections to it. So what happens with their statement, considering it seemed, when I watched the hearing, that they were led to believe that importing 300,000 metric tons was upon the approval of no less than the president himself?
No, I think that's a subject matter that you can equate with equivocation.
Mm.
That was their perception. But if you look at post hoc activities or events, this was not implemented. This was declared illegal. So I think now I don't want to preempt my other colleagues. It's different when you talk about one's perception that can probably lead to false truths, so to speak.
Mm.
So they were made to believe by whom? That was their own subjective interpretation of events.
Mm-mm.
So, but the events would later prove that what they did was illegal. So that is what we're trying to uncover right now.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
for the last two hearings, I think we have sufficient evidence to. Established evidence to really make an objective conclusion to this.
Okay. Now, Senator Tolentino, Chairman, sugar order number 4, the actual order itself, whose signature did it have?
The signature of Mr. Sebastian, the USEC, plus the three other board members.
Mm-mm. And it did not have the signature of the executive secretary nor the president himself, to clarify.
No signature. If you look at the four corners of the document, you won't find any signature.
Okay. Now, Executive Secretary Vic Rodriguez said the resolution was only drafted and it never materialized. Would this be enough reason, in effect, to assume that no corruption happened?
It's a conclusion that is pregnant with presumptions that will have to be based on evidence that I've said.
Mm-hmm.
So just wait for the final report.
Okay. Now, of course, I'm hoping we can talk about this without actually. I understand.
You know, there in court there is such a thing as sub judice rule. So
yeah.
I think
well, this
I
is in to... aid of legislation.
Yes.
I mean,
yes.
frankly
it
speaking,
would be, it
this
would
is in
be
aid in
ethic...
legislation.
Yes.
Okay.
But it would lead to filing of cases. It could lead to filing
it
of
could.
Charges.
Yeah.
So I would endeavor to be objective here, fair.
Yes, yes.
I would not divulge anything that would impinge on or preempt the actions of my other colleagues.
No, but I would like to ask you about essentially the hearings that have already transpired.
Yes,
so for
yes.
example, in the hearings, the former SRA administrator, Serafica, said he didn't consult the board in drafting the sugar order number 4. So in terms of processes...
That has been established.
And he admitted it himself.
Yes.
Should he have consulted the board? What is the process, actually, when a sugar order is drafted?
There is a board. There's supposed to be a board. It's
okay.
It's a corporate body. It has a juridical personality itself, but within the SO number 4, there's a provision there that the board's decision would have to be lodged on a single person alone, and that's Mr. Serafica that you mentioned. So if you tie all of these things and connect the dots, there is something beyond a mere circular or order. It's the lodging of too much discretionary powers on one person.
Okay. Now, based on the hearings, who do you believe made the decision to draft sugar order number 4? I mean, clearly it's established that Serafica is one and Sebastian, would you say, is the other one? Who are the others who you believe were responsible for making the decision to draft the sugar order?
I cannot make the outright conclusion, but the personalities you mentioned right now are really involved. And in fact, the established evidence would show that they acted with the impression that they were authorized.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a conclusion coming from them.
Mm-mm. Okay. What changes, Senator? I mean, I know the hearing isn't over yet, but offhand, what changes do you believe should be implemented in the Sugar Regulatory Administration? And do we still need the SRA?
I think we cannot do away with the SRA immediately overnight and replace it with another body.
Mm-hmm.
But perhaps we should tighten some of the provisions that can lead to discretionary powers on several individuals, coming from Executive Order Number 18 itself. For instance, it would be more proper to have a 5-man board that as what came out during the last hearing. It has to be an odd number. Two, it really has to be a collegial body deciding for the sugar industry, and the powers of the administrators should be clipped for mere internal administration within the agency, and the matter of reclassifying should really be based on market needs and decisions coming from the board based on real consultation. So we can thrash this out and make finer provisions in our proposed amendments to Executive Order Number 18, plus the suggestion that the SIDA law of 2015 should really be implemented.
Okay. All right. I'll go back to that. I'm reading right now a statement of Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel, where he says the Blue Ribbon investigation cannot and should not be closed until and unless some members of the committee get to cross-examine Executive Secretary Rodriguez on the testimony he gave. This is our right as members of the Blue Ribbon Committee and also as a matter of fairness to those mentioned in the testimony in a very negative light. What are your thoughts on this?
He's correct.
Okay.
There's got to be a right to cross-examine. I agree.
Okay.
So my thoughts,
the statement of the hearing will come to a close soon, and E.S. Rodriguez saying
We will still endeavor to invite him if he can be present via Zoom virtually, just like what we're doing, so be it. And if he is willing to provide the committee in advance the answers to the twin questions that I posited during the earlier part of this interview, it's also good. But again, the two issues will have to be answered. If you will repeat your question, my answer is I concur.
Okay. All right. Now, Senator Tolentino, if Executive Secretary Rodriguez chooses not to attend, which in the past in some administrations I've seen cabinet members choose not to attend Senate hearings, but will this affect his chances in the Commission on Appointments?
I don't want to jump the gun because I'm also a member of the Commission on Appointments.
But so, will it have a bearing? Will it have a bearing on the Commission on Appointments when he faces the Commission on Appointments? Will it benefit him to attend in terms of being appointed? Or in terms of being confirmed?
I am not at liberty to conclude that it will have a direct bearing. But in terms of frankness, in terms of candidness, in terms of transparency, in terms of the ability to coordinate with the legislative branch, these are factors that probably would be considered by some members of the commission.
All right. Now, overall, there's a bigger picture in terms of the production of sugar. Several raids or visitations have been conducted in warehouses, discovering right now sacks, thousands of sacks of sugar in these warehouses. What do you make of this, Senator Tolentino? Do you believe the sugar shortage is artificial or it's real? And those sacks are really just set aside for commercial use? What are your thoughts on the whole system that's being discovered?
Indeed, there are indications, red flags, so to speak, as we experience shortage, as claimed by the private sector and some other members of the supermarket groups, et cetera, et cetera. Why are these bags and bags, warehouses of sugar, not being utilized? So it as an ordinary sugar user, consumer, probably you will conclude that these were made artificially to jack up the price. But then again, to set everything in the right perspective, the current Blue Ribbon investigation is focused on SO number 4.
Yeah.
There will be collateral matters that will be touched upon, including the raids, which probably is not really part of our jurisdiction right now, the ongoing probe, because we will now be dealing with the smugglers, we will now be dealing with the other customs officials, so to speak. But I believe that these are all part of a series of events that really can be pursued by perhaps the Committee on Agriculture, but it will open the doors that all of these boilerplates documents from bill of lading, from your warehouse receipts, from your releases of imported sugar are part of what has been happening for not just for these months, but even decades ago. So this would involve a deeper understanding of why this is happening. Especially with our quota agreements with the United States and our dilapidated milling stations, provinces. Yeah. Yes.
Oh, no. And I wanted to go back to sugar order number 4. When President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. said, I did not authorize 300,000 metric tons, he opened a Pandora's box, and it was a very transparent declaration that he did not want that much imported sugar in the country. So a few questions in terms of processes that have been revealed in the Senate. I wanted to ask you, so number one, you said that the sugar regulatory administrator should have first consulted the board. That's one. But is it part of the process that before an importation is actually implemented, should the DA secretary sign off on it, and should the president sign off on it? I mean, regardless if this was President Marcos Jr. in the past, should the DA secretary and the president sign off on a sugar importation order?
You should lay down the basics of this. First, we have to commend President Marcos himself.
Yes, definitely.
He was the one who stopped this.
Absolutely.
He was the one who stopped this.
Yeah.
Nipped this in the bud. Declared it illegal.
Yeah.
It was never implemented.
Yes.
The SO4 was never even published in the website of the University of the Philippines. So we have to commend him for that.
Yeah.
But in terms of consulting, you consult the stakeholders below.
Okay.
Is there really a need?
Yeah.
Do a market analysis.
Uh-oh.
Is there really a need? And then your higher ups. But given the exigency of what really transpired and the current situation, the DA, there is yet to be a full-time Department of Agriculture secretary.
No, I mean in the past. What I'm asking for is what are the implementing rules and regulations when it comes to importation?
I think it would be proper and prudent for an SRA board or the administrator acting on behalf of the board, if authorized by the board, to consult first with his higher-ups.
Yeah, that's prudent. But I'm saying, legally speaking, what is he mandated to do? That's my question. That would be prudent.
Yes, he is required to ask his superiors. Because SRA is still part of the Department of Agriculture.
Okay. So, in other words, is it clear that the DA secretary has to sign off on all importations? Is that clear? I mean, in government, is that clear?
He has to authorize the SRA.
The DA secretary?
He has to authorize either through a representative of himself or himself. That's the chain of command. But if you're questioning...
This is just generally speaking, Senator.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. That's why in this instance, President Marcos stopped this.
Yes.
Because he never authorized
that.
So previous boards, I would surmise that previous SRA would have to consult their DA secretary.
Okay. Because the reason I'm asking is kung kalakaran na ito, di ba, Senator Tolentino, parang what's a question on our minds is, the President Marcos nipped this in the bud, pero kung kalakaran na ito noon pa, ang tanong ko is, did the DA...
I'm not aware of what transpired before.
Yeah.
Hindi ko alam yung SO3, hindi ko alam yung SO2, hindi ko alam yung SO1, yung sinasabi mong kalakaran. But then again, it has to be transparent.
Oo. Ang tanong ko kasi, kung ito na ang sistema, o wag kalakaran, is... does the SRA administrator, is he at liberty to make these decisions on his own?
If you follow the law, no.
No.
If you follow Executive Order Number 18, no.
Yeah. So do you believe he could be held legally liable for this, Senator Tolentino?
Again, if you want me to make my conclusions in advance of the Senate report, probably it would be more ethical for me to refrain from answering that question, whether he should be charged or not.
All right. So my last question on sugar, how many more hearings do you believe will the Senate
I think one. Otherwise, we will be going in circles. So that's what I laid down during the first hearing. We start in with the first stage, going into the implementation stage. So it has to be sequential. It has to be structured like your program. It has to end. Otherwise, we will have a never-ending teleserie on this.
All right. Okay. I'll move on to another topic now. Okay. The Senate Blue Ribbon Committee also tackled the overpriced laptops. Okay. Now, generally speaking, sinabi nyo, walang alam si DepEd, the former DepEd Secretary Leonor
Rion. That was coming from the first hearing. That was coming from the first hearing.
Okay.
That was not a, that was in so far as what transpired during the first hearing, and as far as I'm concerned, you can quote me, in my view, in all honesty, as far as I can tell, these are all related. It seems to me that.
Yeah. All right. Now, just a clarification, Senator, and to those watching the show, this is not personal against anyone. Questions I am asking are merely questions for journalistic purposes of me wanting to find out more information. This is not personal against any of the names I have mentioned on Head Start. That's there is no agenda here.
Yes.
All right.
Because we still
there is none.
Presumption
Definitely
of
none.
Innocence.
Yeah. So, Senator, my question is, if the former Secretary Leonor Briones, you believe, had no knowledge of those overpriced...
As far as the first hearing is concerned.
As far as the
because
first.
Because I was asked after the first hearing, there is going to be a second hearing. There might be a third hearing. So we can. I was able to say from my point of view after the first hearing. So we don't know what will happen after the second hearing or the third hearing.
Yeah. So, Senator, generally speaking, does this take a secretary? In other words, is there less liability on a secretary, an agency secretary, if they have no idea? Because the reason I'm asking is when
There are several terms that can be equated with negligence, command responsibility. But I don't want to conclude. I don't want to jump the gun. That was after the first hearing. You know, media will interview you after the first hearing, and then after the second hearing, there will be newly discovered evidence. So you change your view. So during that period, that was my personal view after the first hearing. That honestly speaking, I feel that as far as I'm concerned, in my view, these are all the same.
Yeah. So my question, generally speaking, is coming from the formerly experience. When I interviewed the former health secretary, sinabi niya on Head Start, hindi namin alam ang mga pinurchase ng PSDBM. They were in charge of that. So I've often wondered, what is the responsibility of an agency secretary when it comes to procurement? This is just general, Senator. I am not referring to Secretary Briones specifically, but I have heard this before, that it is the PSDBM, silang namili, silang bumili. So ang tanong ko, ano bang responsibilidad ng isang agency secretary?
I think I stumbled upon, and this will be for the second hearing, I stumbled upon bid document number 4, wherein it states that the agency, the end user agency, insofar as this laptop purchase is concerned, would still have a hand insofar as the technical specifications and other additions relative to the purchase. So it's still a collaboration between PSDBM and the end user agency. So the mere fact that it's PSDBM would not cut off that umbilical cord, so to speak, between the purchaser and the end user.
Okay, so that's clear. So you believe that agency secretaries, regardless of who they may be, cannot use the PSDBM discretion as an excuse?
There is a memorandum of agreement which we revealed during the first hearing, that MOA, which was not done, surprisingly, during the formally deal. There was no memorandum of agreement. Here we have a memorandum of agreement, but that was what I uncovered, that there was even a provision relative to FDA.
Okay.
And it's quite open.
All right. Now, Senator Tolentino, the company that was granted, who was awarded the bid for these laptops, A congressman has already said that he has divested his interests in the company. I believe it is Congressman Koh. And he's already said he's divested it. But you do have some cynics who say, why would that company get that particular contract if not for possible connections coming from who owns or who's behind the company? Are you able to call, Congressman Koh, or do you believe because he said he's divested, that would be enough?
I think that's going to be part of the second hearing. So I don't want to jump the gun. We still have to establish that. The company involved, the incorporators, whether there really was a divestment. So I don't want to preempt the second hearing. So I think it would be better if you interview me after the second hearing.
All right. Okay. Just the last question I'm asking is, have you ever asked, what happened to the laptops? Where are they?
If you recall, during the previous hearing, I was the one who asked for the number of recipients of the laptop. So I will be provided, or if the committee was provided, I will get hold of that records. But I don't have it with me right now.
Okay.
And I think it will run into thousands. So it would be better again if you ask me after the second hearing.
All right. Okay, I'll move on to another topic now.
Yes.
You are asking government officials to actually name their relatives who are suspected terrorists.
This is different from the Blue Ribbon.
Yes, definitely. So I'm not asking you now as chairman, can you clarify exactly what you meant and
And probably the context. The context. I delivered a speech Tuesday, the other day, coming from a holiday, mm-mm, which is a National Heroes Day. Attended several events concerning National Heroes Day, heard several speeches concerning National Heroes Day, that our heroes are not just the heroes that have gone beyond, but our heroes are the living heroes, those working for us to make our society safe, the policemen, the armed forces of the Philippines, our Bureau of Fire Protection members, even our frontline health personnel. So coming from that context, National Heroes Day, and realizing that all government officials, employees, whether you're a secretary or a lowly clerk, are required to file a SALN. The SALN would require you to identify every relative within the fourth degree of consanguinity who are within the government. So I ask, what's the purpose of this? For transparency.
Yeah.
What's the purpose of this? For honesty. Declare your financial background as well as your relatives. And it so happened that I realized that there was an ambush during that day before I delivered my speech. And there were reports that there were relatives of a high-ranking government official, which I would not name ethically. It would be unethical for me to state
in
the program. So is it possible that we follow some rules and trigger the creativity of the Civil Service Commission? We follow the rules. For instance, when you apply for a U.S. visa, you're asked to declare, do you have any relative? Or are you a member of a paramilitary, vigilante, terrorist group which seeks to overthrow your government? If you apply for an Australian visa, are you a member of a group seeking to undermine society, whether in Australia or overseas? So I, connecting all of this, I asked myself, is it now possible if we ask government employees who took their oath after being elected or being appointed that they will abide by the Constitution of the Philippines, protect society, et cetera, et cetera. And every Monday, they recite an oath during the flag-raising ceremony to that effect. So what I mentioned was that, is it now the right time that we likewise declare voluntarily, if we have relatives working in an organization considered as terrorist organization that seeks to undermine Philippine society and organize society? I don't see anything wrong with that.
Yeah. And I think for the benefit of our viewers, the context of this is actually in an interview, you pointed to the recent, I'll read this, you pointed to the recent arrest of CHED chairperson Prospero De Vera's sister. She was arrested for multiple murder and alleged links to the Communist Party of the Philippines and the New People's Army. So this is the context of you making that suggestion.
Yes, and an ambush that transpired during the day when I delivered my privileged speech in Maguindanao, killing the chief of police.
Now, you have some sectors that are concerned that this could be prone to abuse. What do you think of that?
Mine is just a, if we really want a more stable, peaceful society, access to sensitive files relative to national security should really be limited to those with security clearances. And if you really, like the democratic way of life, if you really are a part of an organized society under a constitution, there's nothing wrong with that. Why is it that SALN is a violation of SALN, failure to disclose an item, can lead to your disqualification or removal from office? But again, I stated this, that even if you disclose your siblings' connections, this should not be taken against you. Mere belief is not sufficient. There has got to be an overt act that there is an organized group, alam naman natin kasi an organized group, that will undermine society itself. So this is the real context of where I came from. Again, the backdrop is the day before the National Heroes Day, which we celebrate every year.
Senator Tolentino, before we go to the Senate bill you filed, you've also expressed the belief that the PSDBM should be abolished. That's correct?
Correct.
Okay.
That's now, on the record, sir. Yes.
All right. Now, given that the budget is now being deliberated in the lower house and the PSDBM still exists, what safeguards do you believe should be put in place so that not just the PSDBM, but even the PITC, that, you know, the parking of funds and questionable purchases with the PSDBM can be avoided?
So your question has something to do with the accepted longevity of both agencies. Am I correct?
Well, not necessarily, but for the 2023 budget, because it will be, I mean, it's being deliberated now, and I know by the year, by this year, you would both houses would want that passed.
So if PSDBM or PITC won't be abolished this
or
year,
or not yet,
not yet as part of the budget, I think the provisions on in my mind, two items would really be the forefront. One, they should not be allowed to invest funds they have in possession. It's not it's not supposed to be treated as trust funds investable. They were supposed to purchase products for the agency. So it's now tied to my second idea that there has to be a time frame for purchasing. You don't purchase within 2 years or a year. If it is an emergency purchase, it has to be based on the needs of the agency. It has to be done within a few months, subject to the requirements of the Procurement Act or Republic Act 9184. Number three, we have to really define the meaning of CUSE, Common Use Supply Equipment. These are the three items that would have to be highlighted during the budget hearings. So I was told during the first hearing wherein the new PSDBM chief appeared that he is for reforms. And I was told, I was informed through anecdotal news reports that the DBM chief is asking for a new lease of life or give, quote-unquote, give PSDBM another chance. So we weigh all of these things in the light of previous events or incidents.
Okay. All right. That's a very good point, what you said, the time frame for purchasing, because the Commission on Audit has flagged PSDBM for non-deliverables or delayed deliverables, I believe, right, in the last 3 years. So that's a very good addition.
Too much.
Right?
That's too much. Oh. 3 years is too much.
Oh, no, I mean, since 2019, that's what I meant. 2019, yes. 2020. But moving on, you filed a Senate Bill number 399, in which public school teachers and the children of public school teachers can avail themselves of scholarship grants. What makes this Senate bill different from existing scholarship grants today that we have, for example, with DepEd or with SHED? What's the difference, Senator?
I would equate it to the word mandatory.
Okay.
It would require state universities, colleges to really give mandatory slots to the children of our hardworking public school teachers who on a day-to-day teaching experience would sell other products just to augment the resources, and would even conduct post-classroom tutoring to their neighbors or other just to add to their resources. And I've seen children of public school teachers who never went to college.
Yeah, good point.
And I've seen public school teachers who really aspired to have a master's degree, but because of unavailable resources, never got that opportunity. So we opened the doors.
Yeah.
We opened the doors to others.
Uh-oh. Okay, I'll read a part of your Senate bill. It's providing public school teachers with scholarship grants to obtain their master's, their doctorate, and their postgraduate education, which would be very helpful in terms of teacher growth. But what are you envisioning, Senator Tolentino? For example, if I'm a public school teacher, kung gusto ko magmaster sa UP, will that mean automatically na dapat, because I'm a public school teacher, dapat pasok na ako, libre na ako? Ganun ba yun, Senator?
I look at it within the confines of your region for purposes of convenience.
Okay.
There are good.
Uh-oh.
It will enable state universities to upgrade their competencies as well as the available teaching resources facilities. So doesn't have to be an automatic slot within the University of the Philippines system, but at least the opportunity is there for you to avail.
Yes, that's one. And an interesting one I find is their children, right?
Yes.
So you're right. You have teachers who are sacrificing their lives teaching. What are you envisioning for the child of a public school teacher? Halimbawa, yung batang yun, anong, when you say mandatory saan? Kunwari, ano?
Mandatory for the ahead. State colleges to provide slots.
Ayun.
For the children. Yes.
Mm-mm.
But you don't force a student to go to school. You don't force a student to have this course. If the available school slot within his residential area or jurisdiction is accounting or agriculture, you don't force it. If the child would want engineering, so be it. At least we will have an educated cadre for the next generation. We will have a generation of Filipinos who are really adept in what Philippine society should be, not just for their own personal lives, but how they would be able to contribute to society in general.
All right. Okay. I wanted to ask you just very quickly. I mean,
One more bill. I have another bill which I have yet to file.
Okay.
It's a bill that would be very exciting, albeit controversial for some.
Okay.
And I would call it, probably have it filed next week or next week. It's called the Gig Economy Act of 2022.
Okay. And can you just quickly, sir, give a summary of that, an overview?
I consider part of the gig economy, GIG. The hardworking, motorcycle riding, delivery personnel who would deliver your food items, who would deliver your books, who would deliver your clothing attire, even if it's raining, even if it's too hot. Sometimes you would see female riders. Sometimes they're converging an area before entering a subdivision, before entering a residential area, but they're not paid well. They're not paid well. You ask them, how much are you getting out of your three rides per day? So I would follow the experience right now being formulated in the state of California and some European nations, that this delivery personnel born out of our lockdown experience should be treated as regular employees. Kawawa naman sila, nauulan na, nainitan.
Of the company. That's a good start. Yes. Of the company.
Sa nainitan, alam nyo yung, what they earn? Pag wala ng pansukli na 5 piso, 3 piso, yun na yung tip. Yun na yung tip. But the danger, I've seen 2 weeks ago, I've seen one.
Absolutely, tumilapon sa EDSA.
Yes, sa Quezon Avenue po yung nakita ko, nakahiga po doon. Natapon na yung siguro yung pagkain na deliver. So they work hard for the economy, and this will continue even after the lockdown, even after COVID. Nasanay na tayo we order online, in the provinces, even in Tagaytay, online na lahat. But the hazard, the danger, 24/7, even 2 a.m. You can see delivery boys working hard for their family just to raise some cash for the
so that's a good one. You want them regularized.
Yes, that's for the gig economy, and I foresee that this delivery online digital economy would still blossom in the years ahead. That's why we have to prepare and we have to protect our workers. Without them, without our delivery boys riding on scooters, you won't have your necessary items in your doorsteps even midnight. Kawawa talaga yon.
Okay. All right.
I will have to deal next week or next week.
All right. And I do hope to have you again, sir. We can talk about that at length. Thank you so much, Senator Francis Tolentino, Chairman of the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee, for joining me this morning on Head Start, sir. You take care.
Have a good day. Thank you, ma'am.